Chester Freeman a couple weeks ago, and he gave me permission to share this conversation with you this morning. Elder Chester and I were in the office, and we were talking about our church signs outside. And he was saying to me, "Pastor, I think we need another sign." And we love our signs, our beautiful blue signs out there. And he was saying, "But I think we need more signs. Our signs really communicating to this community who we are and what we stand for. And are they inviting enough to the people who want to come and be with us?" So Chester and I, Elder Chester and I, were having this conversation about our sign. You all know that signs are a form of communication, amen? They communicate something to the world, to people passing by, even to ourselves. And so I believe our church sign speaks volumes about what we believe and who we are. Sometimes church signs can communicate messages that we don't intend for them to communicate. I don't know about you, but I've seen some really funny church signs, some really weird church signs that sometimes did not communicate what the people intended. Let me tell you a couple of these that I found when I went to look them up. I found one church sign that said, "Don't let worries kill you. Let the church help." I don't think that's what they intended to say. I found another one that said, "This is a good time to visit our church. The pastor is on vacation." How about this one? This church sign said, "Trust in God, but lock your car." And this was the one I really thought was really amazing. This church sign: "Whoever stole our air conditioner, keep it, because where you're going, you're going to need it." Who would put that on church sign? You know, our lives are a sign. Our very lives are a sign. We are human signs, aren't we? Salt and light. Two very common elements that Jesus uses as metaphors to describe us as his followers. We are salt and we are light. This text today, this very short snippet that I read to you, came from a larger text called the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount, and it is sandwiched between the Beatitudes that Jesus gives his blessing to the disciples and between what we're going to do when we get angry. So right in the middle of that is this beautiful metaphor about salt and light, that we are the salt of the earth and we are the light of the world. Now notice that Jesus did not say, "You are going to be salt," or "You are going to be light." Jesus said emphatically that right now, today, this very moment, that we are salt and we are the light of the world. Salt has some very wonderful qualities that you know. Salt adds flavor. Salt adds flavor, doesn't it? Salt adds flavor to things that are tasteless and bland. Salt brings some bam and some zing to food and makes it come alive, right? You know, we sprinkle a little salt in those mashed potatoes because we want to give it just a little bit extra flavor. So it is when we are Christians, we are salt. When we show up anywhere in the name of Jesus, we ought to add a little flavor. Amen? We ought to bring a little zing and a little bam to the conversation and to the area. Wherever we are, whatever we're doing, God asks us to be salt. Amen. Salt is also a preservative. Back in the day when they did not have refrigerators, people had to add salt, a lot of salt, to their meat, particularly to their foods, to keep them from spoiling. Amen. Jesus said we ought to be a preservative. We bring salt to the present and the presence of God in our homes and our churches and everywhere we keep things from spoil. Amen? When we show up, we are like a preservative. We preserve the sanctity of the scripture, and we preserve when we go out and when somebody's telling a funny joke or a nasty joke, we preserve the sanctity of that moment, reminding them who Jesus is. We are to be preservatives. And then salt is a purifier. Salt is a purifier. My grandmother, Lily, my maternal grandmother, if you had a wound or anything, you didn't let her know, because her remedy was to put some salt on. So if you cut your finger, she would wash it well with soap and water, and then she'd take a little salt and rub it in there, and you'd hold on for dear life. And she'd say, oh, baby, this is going to heal. This will be fine. And she would put salt in your wound because salt is a purifier and it helps the body to heal. Amen? Amen. Did you know that these very common elements of salt is a miracle. Salt is a miracle. Salt is a combination of two deadly elements, sodium, chloride, right? And either of these, if they're ingested by themselves, would kill us. Sodium or chloride ingested alone would kill us. But when you combine sodium and chloride together and you get salt and you add a little iodine in it, you get this wonderful thing we call table salt. Don't you know we are a miracle? Just like salt. Don't you know, brothers and sisters, that we are a miracle? We are a miracle. God took two deadly elements called sin and death. And he mixed them together and poured the blood of Jesus on top of it. And in his grace and his mercy, when they came together, we benefited and we became benefits of salvation. And we are miracles. Amen? For the Jewish community, salt was a sign of a covenant relationship between them and God. And so it is, it's still a sign. Salt is a sign of our relationship with God and God's relationship with us. It is a reminder of God's promises to us. We don't need to wear big signs hanging around our necks, and we don't need to wear big t-shirts and telling people who we are. Our lives, as we live for Jesus Christ and do those good works that we read in Isaiah, our lives are a sign. And don't you know that people are always reading your sign? My sign? Somebody is always reading our signs. People place signs in places where they get the most visibility, right? Chester and I talked about this. The sign at the corner of Lincoln and Columbus. The sign in the middle of the block on Lincoln. We need signs to be in places of high visibility so that everybody can see our sign. What good is a sign if it has no light? Especially when it's dark. We have these church signs and they have no light, and we have these beautiful signs, but in the darkness of the night, nobody can read our sign. So what good is a church sign if there is no light to illuminate it? And so our Savior continues, and Jesus says, you are the light of the world. Now most of the time in the scriptures, when we see Jesus and light, Jesus is referred to the light of the world. Isn't it amazing that in this text, he says to us, brothers and sisters, believers, that we are the light of the world. Jesus calls us the light. And our purpose is to illuminate so that others can see Jesus, so that others can see the good works that we do, but give God the glory. One of the properties of light is illumination. Back in Jesus' day, most people had a candle. One small candle would illuminate the whole house, and they put it on a lampstand. And so they put this light on a lampstand, and the whole entire house would be illuminated. But it was hard. They didn't have matches people. They didn't have these little big things that we have that we can start fires easily. And so it was hard to get those lights to remain. So instead of blowing them out, they would take them and they would put them under an earthen bushel so the light would remain, but it wouldn't give out much illumination. Jesus said, "You are the light of the world. Who lights a candle and puts it under a bushel?" But no. You put it on a lampstand so that it would give light to all who are in the house. God never said, "You are the light of the church." God said, "We are the light of the world." Our light is to shine so that all the world can see our good works and that God can get the glory out of our lives. Light is also used as a guide and as a warning. An airplane pilot, I know about you, but when that plane is coming in, I'm looking to see if that runway is lit up. Amen? I don't want him flying blind. I want to see that runway, lights on both sides, and I want to see him coming into that runway, and I'm looking out the window, and I'm making sure he's right in that middle between those lights.
Amen.
Those lights are a guide to bring that airplane pilot and all of the passengers in safely. And lights are also a warning. And go to any railroad crossing, and you'll see those big arms come down, and those red lights are flashing, and they don't want you to cross them. And don't you know some people cross anyway? But that it's a warning. It's a warning to let us know, do not cross now. I'm always amazed. How many Patriot fans do we have in here? Don't be afraid. Don't be scared. It's okay. How many folks are here rooting for the Patriots this afternoon? I got one, Joe. How many Falcon fans are in here? I got a lot of Falcon fans in here today. It's okay. This is not a trick question. I'm always amazed. Super Bowl 51, the Patriots and the Falcons. I'm always amazed at the amount of money that advertisers will spend in order to have their 30-second commercial during the Super Bowl. These prices are mind-boggling. Okay? It says that a 30-second ad today as you watch the Super Bowl can cost up to $4 million. A 30-second ad can cost up to $4 million. That is mind-blowing money for a 30-second ad. In 2011, at that Super Bowl, Taco Bell, all you Taco Bell lovers, Taco Bell spent $12.4 million to have their little Taco Bell commercial during the Super Bowl. Astounding. The world will invest. My point is, I know you think I digress, but I didn't. My point is, the world will invest heavily. The world will invest in crazy ways in stuff they want us to see. A 30-second commercial. The world will invest millions of dollars for their sign. Should we not, as Christians, invest highly? We may not have $4 million to invest, but shouldn't we invest highly in our life sign so that people can see Jesus Christ in us? People are always reading our signs. Whether you know it or not, they were reading your signs when you got in the car and drove the First Presbyterian Church today. They know you go to that church on the corner of Lincoln and Columbus, and they're reading your signs all the time to see if you really are a Christian. So, since our lives are signs and people are always reading us, then we must keep our signs up to date. Amen? Whether we want to believe it or not, for many people, the church has become irrelevant. I know that's hard to swallow. The world sees the church fighting and squabbling and in a lot of cases, the world may wonder, is the church outdated? Do we really need organized religion? Do we need the church? Is the church irrelevant? Is it outdated? Is it old fogey? Have we lost our saltiness? and our ability to influence the world? Does it make any difference that we are Christians? Does it make any difference on our job and in our families? Are we salty Christians in a good way? Have we lost our saltiness? And what can you do with salt that has no saltiness? Jesus said, you throw it out, it cannot be used. Jesus said, it is worth nothing but to be trampled on by people because it has lost its flavor. Jesus said, we are to let our light shine, and that means that we have the choice. We can be lights, or we can put it under a bushel and we can hide it. But we must show our signs to the world. We must not be ashamed or be timid. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but God has given us a spirit of love and of power and of boldness. And we must show our life signs, our human signs to the world. The sign we read about is in Psalm 112 this morning. The sign of justice and righteousness, and the signs of good works, and the signs of feeding the hungry and dressing the naked, and doing good and doing right, and opening our mouths when we see injustices happening, and doing those things that bring God glory. These are our signs. I think there are a few things that are more pitiful than an old, outdated sign. An old, outdated sign says nobody cares. Amen? Nobody cares about the place where the sign represents. Nobody cares about what's on the sign. Letters hanging off. Letters falling off. Words misspelled. Sign needs paint. Nobody cares. Pretty pitiful. I visited a couple of church websites. I'm always on the World Wide Web, and I visited a couple, after my conversation with Chester, I visited a couple of church websites, and I found that some of the information on the websites was about 3 years old. This one website, church website, everything on there was 2014. I was like, wow, who's in charge of keeping this up? Who's in charge of making sure that this is relevant and important and updated? And I have told our media team, you can ask any one of them, I say, keep it current or shut it down. Amen? Amen. Is that right, Sister Pat? I say, keep it current, keep it updated, keep it relevant, or shut it down. I'd rather have no presence than a bad presence. Amen? Amen. Amen. It's important the way we are seen in our signs. God, we want God to be glorified when people see our good works. We don't want to get the credit. We always, always, in all that we do, we want to point people to Christ. And so how do we do that? How do we live our lives so that we're a sign? Again, I want to reference the psalmist this morning, Psalm 112. I want you to go back and read that again. I want to reference Isaiah 58. Is this not the fast that I have chosen, said the Lord, to undo heavy burdens? Go back and read that beautiful passage in Isaiah. This is the way we are to do good works and to have signs that point us to Christ. I found one more sign. And this is a beauty. I have to share. Now listen to me carefully, because I want to make sure you hear this right. I found this one last sign. It said, Lent, the season of Lent is coming. Get your ashes in church. I said ashes. That was on a church sign. Lent is coming. Get your ashes in church. But I think we all know what they were trying to say. Yes. Brothers and sisters, our lives are a sign of God's grace and God's mercy in and on our lives. And we are always being read by somebody. We are God's hands and feet and eyes, and our lives are God's signs. So keep your sign updated so that the world may look at us and they may see Jesus.